Syntolkning, rubrik tillbakablick. Eva Hamilton är moderator.
I onsdags i förra veckan så enades ju EU-länderna och parlamentet om en ny klimatlag för att koldioxidutsläppen ska ha minskat med 55% fram till 2030. Och i fredags så avslutade ju Biden sitt klimatmöte med ledare för ett 40-tal länder. Och där också USA lovar att halvera utsläppen fram till 2030. Och det kom andra löften också, som till exempel Sydkorea som lovade att sluta finansiera kolprojekt utomlands. Flera andra löften kom samtidigt. Robert, din reaktion när det här kom, var du förvånad?
Robert Andrén, GD på Energimyndigheten vid hennes sida.
Nej, lite förvånad men väldigt glad. Jag menar, det finns tre viktiga skäl till att det här, vi ska ta det här på allvar. Det ena är ju att USA tillsammans nu med EU igen tar ledartröjan för klimatets skull och klimatarbetet. Och det är ju jätteviktigt, tillsammans med då andra ledande ekonomier. Det andra är ju att Biden lyfter fram att det här är inte en fråga för miljön eller klimatet bara. Det är ju en ekonomisk tillväxtfråga, en långsiktig lönsamhetsfråga. Mm. Det är en viktig signal. Och det tredje, det är ju faktiskt att den här satsningen man gör nu i USA, det handlar om $2 triljoner. Ja. Med vilka möjligheter för svenska aktörer att komma in där. Och det, vi pratar energisystem, bostadssektorn och vi pratar transportsektorn. Så att, jag menar, det här kan man ju bara applådera.
$2 triljoner, men det är liksom lite svårt att ha koll på de nollorna. Mm. Men låt oss lyssna på hur kommunikationsdirektören på Stockholms Environment Institute, Robert Bort, sammanfattar vad som också har hänt med klimatarbetet under de senaste 2 åren, alltså sedan förra gången Energimyndigheten hade sin energiutblick.
Ett 5 minuter långt videoinslag.
Förändringstakten har varit jättesnabb inom kanske 3 olika områden. Det är politiken, teknologi, men också inom mindset, inom samhället. Och man kan säga att det är lite som en hockeyklubba som går uppåt. På teknikområdet så kanske det har inte jättemycket som är helt nytt. Men man har använt alla de innovationer som man tagit fram och man nu börjar ta dem till en produktionsfas. Man tar till exempel vätgas och använder det för att producera stål utan kol. Och man ser också att elbilar går från att vara ganska sällsynta på gatan till att vara någonting som finns nästan överallt. Ja, det är också så att inom vindkraft man har haft små eller medelstora vindkraftverk som producerar i snitt 3 megawatt el till nu att det är 5 och havsbaserat så är det 10 megawatt. Och så har priset på vissa teknologier rasat neråt också som gör att de är ju konkurrenskraftiga med fossil energikällor. På den politiska fronten så då har vi sett ganska stora förändringar sedan 2019. 2019 så var det en ny kommission som kom fram. De la fram ett paket, gröna given, som satte nya mål. Och hela paketet handlade om att ställa om den europeiska ekonomin till någonting som levererade på klimatfronten men också på biologisk mångfald. Och sen har vi sett att samma sak har hänt i andra länder, framförallt inom klimatpolitiken där det här netto nollutsläpp vid 2050 har varit någonting som sprider sig till USA, till Sydkorea och även 2060 till Kina. Den stora förändringen, det är ju en förändring i mindset. Det är en förändring inom politiken. Det är också en mindset som har förändrats inom samhället. Och där vill jag säga att det är ju ungdomar som kanske har visat ledarskap där. Och inte minst Fridays for Future och skolstrejk för klimatet. Inom finanssektorn så ser man att vissa stora investeringsbolag, pensionsfonder har börjat ansluta sig till ett globalt mål som tillsammans de kommer förändra deras investeringar så de också är netto noll vid 2050 för att det är lönsamt. Man kan se att man kan ha en avkastning när man investerar i de här nya teknologier, förnybar energi. Men också sen när näringslivet kliver fram och säger nej, men vi vill verkligen göra så här. Vi vill nå både mål 2030 och 2050. Att då höja politiken, kanske både krav men också möjligheter. Industriklivet som Sverige har lagt fram har möjliggjort att till exempel energibolag, gruvbolag och storbolag samarbete för att ta fram en stål utan att använda kolkraft. Jag tror det är genomslaget är för att vi jobbar på ett annat sätt. Vi ser ett sätt att jobba i symbios, ett partnerskap mellan offentligt sektorn, myndigheter, forskning och inte minst näringslivet och finanssektorn. Jag tänkte på ett citat från en amerikansk författare, L.P. Hartley. Och det är ju att det förflutna är ett främmande land. Det verkligen är så att för 2 år sedan så kanske vi stod på tröskeln på en stor förändringsprocess. Men vi anade inte riktigt hur stor och hur snabb den kunde vara. Och den här resan 2019-2021, den har varit jättespännande, jättefort. Och egentligen nu sitter vi på en punkt där ja, vi kan verkligen möta utmaningen med klimatomställningen och energiomställning. Bara att man jobbar i partnerskap och tillsammans. Då kommer man uppåt.
Robert Watt intervjuades under en promenad.
Robert Watt, Stockholm Environment Institute. Det var Astrid Holm som intervjuade honom på Djurgården här i Stockholm. Ibland misströstar jag att det går så trögt, att isbergen smälter och tundran tinar. Men efter den här senaste veckan så, och också efter Robert Watts då, sammanfattning av de senaste 2 åren så känns det plötsligt att det rör sig i rätt riktning.
Gästerna finns med digitalt.
Välkommen Svante Axelsson som är National Coordinator för Fossil Free Sweden. Och välkommen Monica Raya, born in Costa Rica. But currently working and living in Amsterdam from where you are joining us right now, right? Monica is a member of the UN Climate Champion team, and she's also key advisor to the UK presidency's Clean Transport Campaign. Och hörni, när ni efter detta seminarium är klara så kolla in Monicas TED Talks från förra året om transporter, det rekommenderar jag. The two of you were a success at Energiutblick 2 years ago, so we asked you to start up this year as well. Och till er, vår publik, skicka era frågor via den här frågefunktionen så fångar Johanna Whitlock upp dem och Svante och Monica kan svara sen i slutet av det här blocket. Svante, after the news from EU and from Bidens top meeting last week, what is your conclusion? Please problematize a little bit what happened.
Yes, it's amazing to see how the politicians now have raised their ambitions. And as many already have said, I think the most crucial thing is that they have changed their language. They have changed the mindset. They talk more about more egoistic, you can say, argumentation for the nation. They talk about co-benefits, jobs, health and competition. And that's very, very hopeful because that's changing the whole discussion. I don't think we need so much of a negotiation process when we talk about burden and burden sharing. Now we talk about benefit sharing and how we can speed up. And also in Sweden, we have the same mindset. And we also have industrial leaders that say we want to speed up the tempo because we are afraid of that it will go too slow, not too fast. So their willingness to pay has increased enormously all over the world. So I think now we have a race out of the fossil energy era. And that's very, very hopeful because now we have a new argumentation. We talk about benefits, how we can increase the welfare. And I think Sweden has been a leader in that type of language because we want to be the first fossil-free welfare nation and talk about how we can increase the welfare by being fossil-free. A total opposite to the old traditional argumentation.
Thank you, Svante. You're inducing a positive attitude and hope in this. Monica, what is your analysis of what happened last week?
Well, let me build on what Svante said, because it's definitely very good news. And 2 things that I would like to stress that are worth thinking about. One is the fact that even though it's a climate conversation, they have a whole of government approach. So this is no longer the topic of one department, and they have been very good at communicating that there is a group of people throughout the government that are going to mainstream that in their everyday work. And that's a very big difference with the approach we had before, because as you know, this has been we humans tend to work in silos, and the US was not an exception. So that is also a very important signal. So that is not an environmental problem as some people used to frame it. And the other thing, coming from a small country and being very aware that there are two big countries out there, the US and China, and you know, with all the complexity that that involves, it's a very positive signal that despite the fact that the bilateral relationship between these two countries has suffered, they have been able to isolate climate, and they were able to have a very civilized conversation in the days and the run up to the COP, to the summit. And I think that signaled that the two countries were willing to recognize that when it came to climate, it was worth sitting out around a table and agreeing, perhaps not in the formal sense of an agreement, but you know, agreeing to cooperate and to send the signal that this is one of the most defining challenges of our time. So yeah, I was happy, and knowing as always that this is not enough. So it's not I don't want to come across as being complacent, but yeah, I was happy.
So you were happy, but still China didn't come up with anything new, and no promises, no new kind of goals that they were setting.
Yes, this is something that has to be recognized. And I find that what we need to do is to make sure that those channels that the big countries have with China are there. But on the other hand, I do find that something very interesting is happening, at least in Latin America, which is, and we can talk about it more, and I would be very happy to hear Swante and other speakers. But at least when it comes to transportation, there has been a very open channel with China in terms of buses and trucks. So I would be very, very interested in understanding how, for example, in that particular sector, Europe could be more active in the region, given that we need to electrify, we need to make sure that transportation is zero emission. So it's something that I'm very keen to talk about with Swedish colleagues, given that this is such an important sector for your industry.
Monica and Svante, it's so good to see you together again, although on a digital context. And as much as I applaud what happened last week, I'm quite curious about how you see the local movement and the need for it. To me, that will be a crucial thing. So how can we better engage, empower and equip the local communities actually to make a difference?
Start with Svante.
Yeah.
Yes, I think that's very, very important. And I'm really afraid about the public opinion, because I think people in the streets still are more afraid about the changing of the society than climate change. So we are a little small group that talk about the possibilities and see how we can change and how we can build a better world. But many people, I think, in Sweden and other places in the world is afraid of changing the society. And that's why it's so important that we have a strong storytellers. The business leaders is perhaps the most important storytellers, because people in Uddevalla and Borlänge and so everywhere rely on the local leaders. And if they say it's good for the job in Kiruna, it's good for the job in Luleå, it's good for the welfare, and we got more tax revenues if we change, then they believe that this is the better world. And then they also accept rather ambitious politicians' decision. We need to be local, and we work very hard in that perspective in Fossil Free Sweden. We talk about the local municipalities, and we work with six cities now and local municipalities, and also make local regional action plans. So it will come back to the people in everywhere where they wherever live.
Yeah, you do a fantastic job with Fossil Free Sweden, that's for sure. Monica, your perspective, please.
Sure. So, yeah, and congratulations, because I take a lot of inspiration from Sweden. So several things. One is that absolutely, you know, if you don't have that energy from people, it doesn't survive a crisis. It doesn't survive a change of government. It doesn't survive, you know, an instability in public policy. So how do we do that? Well, there are several ways, and of course, there is no magic formula. But one of the things we've learned, in it doesn't matter whether it's Costa Rica, Latin America, Europe, California, one of the things we've learned in the last 2 years, since I last saw Svante and I saw you, is that you do have to be very good at connecting the topics. So it's rule number one, do not make it only about climate or only about the economy or only about health. We have to be very good at telling the story of building something that is good for people from different, you know, we have to be very good at speaking very different languages. Obviously, if you have a CEO, if you are at Davos, you have to use a certain narrative, that's for sure. But you have to, all of us will have to be very good. And I have tried really hard at also being able to go to a person that is not an engineer and a person that breathes bad air and a person that takes the bus every day and say, hey, do you want to be part of this? Because imagine if you could take a bus that doesn't have a tailpipe. Imagine that it's silent. Imagine that your kid can stand behind and can, you know, will realize that there is no tailpipe exhaust coming. So one of the lessons that we're building on, you know, one of the lessons we've learned from observing good examples, and by we, I mean people working, for example, of zero emission transportation, is what happened in California last year. Because the alliance that happened there was a combination of business people, people in frontline communities, scientists, EV associations, and basically they won the case that a clean tracking rule was due, you know, that it had to be ambitious, that it had to be urgent. And in the middle of a pandemic in the US, they were able to send the signal that that was good for the frontline communities. So back to your question, I think engaging those communities accelerates the action because it's no longer perceived as a luxury or as something that can or should be postponed.
You're both talking about the storytelling, and we will also have two business leaders here in a short while, Martin Lundstedt from Volvo and Jan Moström from LKAB. And I know that you will ask Martin Lundstedt a question then, Monica. But first, Svante, could you just tell us about your more spectacular findings during your work to make Sweden fossil free? You have presented 22 different models now or plans how to do it.
Yes, I'm surprised myself, but the time is right now, I'm most impressed about the language and argumentation, and we have changed our mindset now, and we have a new logic. We talk about how can we speed up. How can we make Sweden as a more competitive country? So many companies, as you, I think we will hear later on, are afraid of the tempo is too slow in Sweden. So now we have the environmental movement and the industrial leaders on the same side, and they want to speed up the tempo. It's not, they are making this changing only by economic argumentation. And that's very, very strong. You can say sign that it's not just for be a nice person or a nice company. They see the argumentation is we need to do this change. Otherwise, we're not part of the market 2030. And when we're talking like that, you also have the unions with you. So it's a new argumentation that we have a very strong change all over the world. And the demand of fossil free products is increasing very, very fast. And we can see that in different sectors. A very interesting perspective, in my view, is that now we talk about the value chain just much more and for just the 1 year ago. And we see a new logic even there, because the final consumer can pay for it. It's very, very low cost for the people who live in the fossil-free society. For example, if you have fossil-free steel, it's perhaps 25-30% more expensive when you produce it. But if when you buy the car, who have this fossil-free steel you have to pay perhaps 2 winter tires more in the cost. So it's very low cost. Even the climate materials of cement is higher when you produce it. But if you look in the buildings, it's perhaps 0.5% more expensive. And that's also very important storytelling, that even when we heard about higher prices when you produce things, it's not costly for the consumer and the people in the country. So that's also a very, very new perspective, and also new perspective how you can finance these more expensive productions. So the steel production is very, very self-confident and see the possibilities now, because the Volkswagen and BMW and Volvo want fossil-free products.
Svante, how can we now together then implement long-term those strategies that we actually see now popping up in various industrial segments and value chains?
Yes, and as I mentioned in the beginning, we need to work together. I say sometimes we need a tango, but I think we need a square dance. We want public procurements. It's very important. I think we need to build fossil climate neutral roads and railways 2030, because that's very important for the steel industry and also for the cement industry, that the public procurement pay for this more valuable products. We need to speed up when you talk about decision makings, and also, of course, to have this grid system. I think the grid system is the bottleneck just now. We have to not produce so much more electricity, but we want to have it in the right place, in the right time. But together, look at municipalities, the government and the opposition parties, the authorities and the business themselves are now working together. I really feel that we now have a very, very unique momentum in Sweden. And that's now also supporting from other countries.
Okay. So, Monica, you have been devoting your time to transportation. Could you tell us a little bit about your crucial findings?
Yes, I would be very happy to do that. So one of the things that I've been working on with many people is around the idea of campaigns that are framed around 100%, because there is power around the idea of doing something in giving it 100% as opposed to targets that are, 65 or 37. So what are those targets that we are trying to mainstream through different campaigns? And by that, I mean campaigns in Europe, campaigns in the US, campaigns in Japan and other key markets. So one of them is the notion that we really have to move to a world where 100% of the sales are zero emissions as soon as possible, no later than 2035. And we know that depending on the company, you will get arguments for why it should be 2030 or 2035. Some companies don't even want to talk about it. But even in the US, GM is saying, well, we could do 2035, which was unthinkable only 6 months ago. Mm-hmm. And is the result also of the Biden administration saying that, all the federal fleets will have to be zero emissions. So you have a moment right now that is very, very important to grasp, because you have something going on in the US, something going on in the EU with the climate law and campaigns to, phase out the internal combustion engine, because, there are companies and NGOs and city leaders that want to do that. Then you also have a crisis with the air quality. So you start getting countries like, Chile, Colombia saying, why do we want to buy diesel buses again if we can buy zero emission buses? Tell me, So a lot of the wisdom that we had on the table suggested that this was something for Europe or something for the US or perhaps Japan, but not in the developing world. And one of the surprises, the very positive surprises that I've had in the last 2 years, is that kind of hunger for zero emission fleets in my own region, when we were told that we had to wait because the technology wasn't ready. So one of the things we are needing to do very quickly is to talk about the scale of opportunity, because it's very easy to get caught up in the idea that, change is expensive. And one of the things that I wanted to put on the table is the fact that, for example, there is something called Zebra in Latin America, and the plan is to raise $1 billion, and they are already, not that they have to start from scratch, they are already talking to investors. They commit to 4 specific cities in Latin America with big fleets. And then what they do is they make a public pledge to say, from a certain date, we're no longer buying diesel buses. And then they go to the bus companies and say, would you be making a public pledge? And would you be willing to source and make sure that city gets zero emission buses?
And Monica, very short, mm-hmm. then, just China has a role here, doesn't it? I mean, China is trying to get into this market.
Sure. So this is my observation, given that I have one foot in Latin America and one foot in Europe. I would really like to see more of an opportunity for European companies in my region, given that the observation I have is that so far, all of the companies that are supplying those zero emission technologies are Chinese. And we could have a conversation about whether that is good or bad. That's a separate conversation. My point is that there is opportunity beyond Europe. And I would very much like Sweden, for example, to tap into that, because I know you have the technologies and the willingness to do this, you know, to decarbonize. So I'm basically saying, let's talk after this seminar and let's make sure that we find very concrete examples that you can be part of. Thank you.
So Monica, before I just let you go, I know you have a question for Martin Lundstedt, Volvo, when he comes here in a short while.
Sure.
What is your question?
Oh, okay. So my question is, why is it that I still see such a divergence when I talk to companies in, for example, Sweden, and I see all that drive, you know, all that spirit of zero emissions. And then I talk to others in Latin America, and they are still saying that, well, you know, we can still stick to diesel, we can still work out the efficiency of these buses. And it seems to me that there is a disconnect. And I would really like to understand whether is something we could narrow or close, because, as I said, the opportunity to tap into that market would be bigger if the local voices representing those brands are not skeptical themselves.
Two different messages, obviously. I'll ask him the question from you, and now we have some questions from our audience. And Johanna, you have got some.
Yes, many questions, but one is for Svante here. You mentioned public procurement, but the question is, what is your view on procurement within the private sector?
That's a very great question, and I think we need to connect the private sector with this public procurement. But as I mentioned, if we come together, we can be very, very strong in what we need and what we are looking for, because when we come together and say what we need in different timetables, you also lower the risks for the investors. So they want to know, when do you need this type of products and how much do you need, and so on. So if we can come together, and we are now working in different regions in Sweden to combine the private sector with the public sector and see what do they need. If we talk about building houses, for example, how fast will we phase out the climate and the fossil energy. So I think that's a very good point. And I also connect with the value chain discussion, because if you look at the Unilever, for example, we know that they want to need 100% recyclable or fossil-free packages 2030. And then the chemical industry know they are going to buy our products, and it's not costly for them to change that type of quality. So we need to work together.
Thank you, Svante Axelsson. Thank you very much, Monica Raya from Amsterdam.
Thank you.